change on blood pressure, where you will be supposed to do on your subject. You will make him lie down in a supine position, and then you will ask the fellow to immediately stand up, and then you will record the blood pressure from supine to standing or sitting posture. There also the baroreceptor reflex will come handy, and the examiners will ask you each and everything about the baroreceptor reflex, right? So very important class for the day, not only because of the theoretical questions in the exam, but also for the very important practical in the physiology labs, which is effect of postural change on blood pressure. Certainly almost more than 50% people get it in the exam, right? So we will be discussing the neurotransmitter mechanism and each and everything. So let us begin with short regulation of blood pressure. What are the various mechanisms? How is BP regulated, right? So just a quick recap, we have seen that this is the main pressure which determines the pressure head, and this is nothing but equal to cardiac output into total peripheral resistance, right? When I say short-term, intermediate and long-term mechanisms of blood pressure regulation, you must be aware that in central nervous system, you have just been taught, so it should be fresh in your mind, reflexes. So remember, reflexes, generally, whenever we say, most of the people always will give the answer that central nervous system has reflexes, or kahin pe nahi hota hai. Theek hai? That is absolutely wrong thing or wrong notion in your mind. What we are going to learn today is a lot of cardiovascular reflexes. And wherever possible, I will be trying to tell you the whole of the entire reflex arc. When I say cardiovascular reflexes, let me quickly give you an overview and then I will start with the various mechanisms. The cardiovascular reflexes are controlled by various centers located in the cardiovascular reflexes are controlled by various centers located in brainstem reticular formation. So your neuroanatomy probably will be right now going what they must have done with neuroanatomy. So they'll teach you in detail the reticular formation. Even we will teach you in physiology. But just remember, as of now, the cardiovascular reflexes are controlled by the brainstem reticular formation. These are also under the higher control of hypothalamus, which you know you have studied in class 11 and 12, also known as head ganglion. So hypothalamus has a higher control over the cardiovascular reflexes, which are mainly controlled by brainstem reticular formation, under control of hypothalamus and the cerebral cortex. Now let us go to the reflex arc, which you should be thoroughly knowing, right? For in any reflex, what are the components? We have, first of all, what am I trying to judge? What am I trying to judge? That is known as stimulus. So first thing is, what are you judging here in cardiovascular reflexes? It could be anything. I'm at least telling you first the most important ones which you need to know. The stimulus could be increase or decrease in blood pressure. Whenever I write BP, I always mean mean arterial pressure, right? Please, that is totally understood. Whenever we write BP, that means we are writing MAP, mean arterial pressure or mean blood pressure. So increase or decrease in BP, or increase or decrease in blood volume. So we have, this could be my stimuli, the first ones. The second type of stimuli could be decrease in PO2, hypoxia, increase in PCO2, increase in hydrogen ion, or decrease in pH. So immediately the bell should ring that yes, what is this? Chemical changes, right? Hypoxia, hypercapnia, acidosis. Now I have the sense organs who will judge these stimuli. They are called as you know from CNS, receptors. Right? Remember in CNS, you must have been taught Golgi tendon, muscle spindle. They also follow this reflex arc pattern. So we have the receptors which are going to judge this sense or sense this stimuli. What are my receptors or sense organs? Very easy to understand now. The ones which are judging the blood pressure or the blood volume, especially the blood pressure, are called by the name baroreceptors. Baro word has come from barotrauma. Must have heard about it. Barotrauma, baropressure, anything related to pressure. So they are known as pressure sensing receptors or baroreceptors. I will be telling you in detail about their location, their innervation, reflex arc, each and everything. This is just a short, quick overview so that we are able to know that how we are going to proceed through, right? So stimulus receptors, the ones which judge these chemical changes, naturally should be called as chemoreceptors. You have studied about them where? In respiratory system. Yes, peripheral chemoreceptors. But where are the examples? Carotid and aortic body, right? Central chemoreceptors located on the ventral surface of medulla. Remember type 1 glomus cells, right? They contain oxygen sensitive potassium cells. Then there is a mechanism, they release dopamine and the ventilation rate increases, right? So receptors, stimulus ho gaya, receptors. Now, I need to sense the information by the receptors and send it to a higher integrating station. It won't go on its own. I need afferent nerves. For both of them, the afferent nerves are the same. Glossopharyngeal and my vagus. 9th is glossopharyngeal, 10th is vagus. This information is going to go to a station known as integrating station. Integrating station is my NTS in medulla. NTS stands for nucleus of tractus solitarius. So I'm writing each and everything for you on this slide. Don't expect me to write these all again and again, right? So we have a lot to cover today. So just I'm giving an overview in the beginning so that next time I say NTS, I ask anyone to unmute and say NTS. Please don't say anything rubbish. Remember, it is nucleus of tractus solitarius, which is located in medulla. What is its purpose? I'll tell you each and everything as we proceed through. After integrating station, once the integrating station receives the information, let me tell you that suppose your blood pressure is increasing. This is judged by the receptors known as baroreceptors. Location, I'll be telling you in a short while. Then the 9th and 10th nerves, the glossopharyngeal and the vagus, sends the information to the integrating station, which is somewhere in medulla, known as nucleus of tractus solitarius. Once the integrating station receives the information that, okay, BP is rising, it will try to normalize your blood pressure. How will it do that? It needs to resend the information out via nerves known as efferents or efferent nerves. Now, which are the efferent nerves here? And which are the effector muscles, also known as effectors? So, efferent nerves are my sympathetic supply. I told you in the last class, T1 to T5, which will supply the effectors, which are my cardiac muscles. Or I can have T1 to L2, which will supply my smooth muscles of blood vessels. Finally, once they do so, they will bring about a response. What is the response? If your BP is rising, then we will try to decrease it back to normal. If it is decreasing, I will like to increase it back to normal. So, increase or decrease leads to normalization of blood pressure or makes the BP normal, right? So, remember, this is an overview of the cardiovascular reflexes. Just to make us understand, they totally follow the same reflex arc pattern as you must have studied in central nervous system. Remember, muscle spindle was also like this. We have a passive stretch, oh, it is being judged by muscle spindle. Then there are nerves known as type 1A and 2, which carry the information to integrating station, which is in the which horn, ventral horn of the spinal cord. We have efferent nerves, which is A-alpha. We have effectors, which is extrafusal muscles. We have response, which is muscle contraction, right? So if everything same is happening here, but we are not talking not about the central nervous system, but about the cardiovascular reflexes. So now let us begin with the CVS reflexes. And as I told you, they are under the control of higher hypothalamic and cortical control. So you should be knowing about two centers in the hypothalamus and the other centers in the reticular formation as well, which control the blood pressure, right? So as we talk, as we descend down from the higher to the lower centers, in the hypothalamus, I have two centers. One is known as the ventral. Another one is anterior. I am now introducing a concept of ventral hypothalamus is known as a pressor area. Anterior hypothalamus is known as a depressor area. So please understand it patiently. This will really help us in the long run. Whenever I say depressor, that means on stimulating the anterior hypothalamus, there would be changes which will lower down your blood pressure. That is the meaning of depressor. Depress karta hai, depresses. When I say pressor, pressor means it stimulates. It will cause increase in blood pressure. So these are centers in the hypothalamus. In the undergraduate level, they might not ask you this, but as the competition is rising day by day, so in the PG exam, they might be asking you what will happen if I stimulate the ventral hypothalamus. And then instead of having a blank face, we should be knowing the answer that ventral is an area which actually will stimulate and increase the blood pressure. So it's a pressor area. Very easy way to remember this. Just take up the first two letters here. So you know, these days nobody likes to take advice, and there is a wonderful idiom in English that don't give advice unless and until asked for. But over here, I'm giving you advice because we say VP, which is Vice President. VP, which is Vice President, needs advice. Vice President needs advice. So ventral is pressor and anterior is depressor, right? So although we shouldn't be giving advice to anyone unless or until they are really after you to and asking you for advice, as we say these days, right? Because you never know when people get offended by any of our advices, right? So better not to give them. But yes, if somebody is asking you, then we must. So normally vice presidents of the companies are in need of advice. And who is the vice president here? The ventral area, right? Just remember this. Then let's progress to the similar way we have centers in the medulla. Similar way we have centers in the medulla. In medulla, we have again two areas. Naturally, one would be the pressor area, the another would be the depressor area. That means I stimulate the following area in the medulla, which is the pressor area, your BP should increase. I stimulate your depressor area, your BP should decrease. Along with this, I see increase in heart rate and also decrease in heart rate. The names of these areas are very, very important for you people to remember. The pressor area has another name. Remember, in the older times, a lot of people are still writing in some books. This center was known by the name vasomotor center. Please listen to this very, very carefully and try to grab this. So in the older books, it used to be called as VMC. And still some older examiner comes and asks you, vasomotor center kya hai? Okay, so don't worry. Maybe he should be aware, but if he is not, then vasomotor center was a term reserved in the older days when they used to call that vasomotor center is a center in medulla has pressor area, depressor area. But right now, the modern concept is that we have a presser area, which is the vasomotor center, but its new name is RVLM. RVLM, which stands for rostral ventrolateral medulla. So you understand caudal and rostral. Rostral is present towards the head side. Caudal is present towards the feet. This much you know from anatomy. So right now, if anyone asks me what is the vasomotor center, I will say RVLM. So RVLM is my vasomotor center. It is a presser area. That means if I ask you what will happen if I stimulate your RVLM, you will say my BP should rise. BP rises, right? And depressor area is just the opposite one. Depressor area is CVLM. CVLM stands for, just I'll need to write one more word here, caudal, and everything else is same. Caudal ventrolateral medulla. RVLM is pressor, CVLM is depressor. Very easy way to again remember this. R for RVLM, R for blood pressure rises. R for RVLM, R for blood pressure rises. Or if you don't like this, another way, A, B, C, D, C ke baad D, C is caudal, D is depressor. Whatever pleases you, whatever way you can put it in your mind, right? I'll take it. So don't give me opposite answers in the exam, otherwise you get zero, right? So this is the most important thing here. The RVLM is a vasomotor center on stimulating which the blood pressure increases. This RVLM, very easy to remember, it is located in rostral part of the medulla. R for rostral, R for BP rises. R and R are together. C is depressor, caudal is depressor. What does the RVLM actually do for us? Let's learn a little bit about RVLM before we move to the baroreceptor. So RVLM is a center located in rostral ventrolateral medulla. The RVLM gives rise to axons. Let's say these are the axons coming out of the RVLM. So RVLM gives rise to the axons, which are coursing or moving dorsally and medially. They move the axons from the RVLM, they arise, they course dorsally and medially, and finally directly project to intermediolateral. So they course dorsally and medially, descend to the intermediolateral column of the spinal cord. So they descend to intermediolateral gray column of the spinal cord. From CNS, you should be knowing that even in spinal cord, we have intermediomedial and intermediolateral. Yahan pe I have written intermediolateral. Please look carefully each and every center here. Again, I am repeating, the axons from the RVLM course dorsally and medially and descend to the intermediolateral gray column of the spinal cord. And from the intermediolateral gray column of the spinal cord arises my sympathetic fibers. So generally, we used to say now that VMC or the RVLM is tonically active. Tonically active means it is always active. It is stimulating your smooth muscles of the blood vessels and keeping them in a contracted state, which is known as tone of the vascular system, right? So how is it able to do that? Let's quickly revise. So RVLM gives rise to axons, which course dorsally and medially and finally descend to the intermediolateral gray column of the spinal cord, from where these sympathetic fibers originate. That means in one line I can say, is the RVLM site of origin of sympathetic nervous system? Absolutely right, right? So RVLM is, that is why it becomes a presser area, because eventually the sympathetic fibers, you all understand, will increase the blood pressure, increase the heart rate. So as I was talking about, from the hypothalamus, we have the vice president who needed advice. Then we have the medulla, in whom I had RVLM and CVLM. And finally, in the spinal cord, we can also remember, in the spinal cord, we have two centers. One I have written over here, intermedio-medial versus intermedio-lateral. Intermedio-lateral is my pressor area. Intermedio-medial is my depressor area. So you have two areas in each way, everywhere, right? So we have a RVLM, which is a vasomotor. We have a CVLM, which is a caudal ventrolateral, which is a depressor. We have an intermedio-lateral, which is receiving the axons from the RVLM. It is a pressor area. And we have an intermedio-medial, which is a depressor area. So, you know, every one of you, as you, nobody will like to stick to being MBBS. So most of you will like to do MD, right? And when you will do MD and you'll be doing internship. So, you know, people of your mind generation, we all love to eat something which you all know what. So we can say the mnemonic for this is MD, which is intermedial, is common for every, intermedial is same for both of them. MD loves pizzas, right? So MD loves pizzas. That is, lateral is pressor, medial is depressor, right? So whatever way you want to remember, you can do that. But these are some important centers to remember. So till now, we have understood that there are areas correspondingly in the hypothalamus, in the medulla, in the spinal cord, which can increase or decrease the blood pressure, because we are discussing the cardiovascular reflexes and the higher control of the blood pressure. And now, one last center I would like to discuss with you, which is again known as the vagal center, which is known as the vagal center. Its older name used to be cardiovagal inhibitory center, CVIC. Again, some Indian authors still persist with this name, cardiovagal inhibitory center. Cardiovagal inhibitory center, CVIC. Just pick up first letters of each one of them. Cardiovagal inhibitory center. The new name of the same now is nucleus ambiguous. Nucleus ambiguous. There are other vagal centers also present, but they do not have much role in blood pressure regulation. Like most of your books mention, I also mention over here so that there is no confusion once you read the book. The another center is dorsal motor nucleus of the vagus. Please remember, it does not have role in regulation of blood pressure, because its neurons mainly project to gastrointestinal tract. And here I'm not discussing GIT. I'm more interested in knowing the BP regulation, right? So this is one additional one which is given in the books. Yes, you need to know it, but remember, it is not helping us in anything related to blood pressure regulation, right? So let's go back. CVIC, older name, new name is nucleus ambiguous. From here, the vagal fibers originate, which supply my cardiovascular system. And you know that the vagal fibers do not supply the ventricles, or very sparse innervation of the ventricles. So they are mainly supplying the atrias, right? They do not supply the ventricles. And the main effect of the vagal fiber would just be decrease in heart rate. The vagal stimulation or stimulation of nucleus ambiguous will lead to decreased heart rate, but will not affect the contractility much. And I have discussed the reason many a time till now, at least 5-10 times, right? That the vagal fibers sparsely or do not innervate the ventricles. And which is my main pump, which helps in pumping of the heart, ventricles, right? So once we are aware of all these areas, now let's switch back to the various mechanisms for regulation of blood pressure. So regulation of blood pressure, short term, intermediate, long term. So I've written down the list for you. Let's quickly see that and then I'll explain you each and every mechanism from this list. So let me enlarge it a little bit. So short term mechanisms are also known by the term rapidly acting mechanisms. They act within seconds to minutes. Why am I calling them as rapidly acting mechanisms? There must be some reason. They act within seconds to minutes. They are very, very fast. They act within seconds to minutes, right? Which are these mechanisms? Baroreceptor, chemoreceptor, CNS ischemic response. Here I will add one more, or Cushing's reflex. Very, very important for the exam, Cushing's reflex, and epinephrine, which is secreted from the adrenal medulla. You would be taught in endocrinology, you should be knowing this, that the adrenal medulla releases both epinephrine and norepinephrine, but epinephrine is released 80% and norepinephrine is only released 20%. So which becomes the dominant source of the epinephrine? You can say adrenal medulla. So adrenal medulla releases much more epinephrine. Intermediate acting mechanisms, as the name is suggesting, they're a little slower than the rapidly acting mechanisms. They act within minutes to hours. So they take a little more time. They act within minutes to hours, right? We have two amongst them which you need to know, minutes to hours, and capillary fluid shift mechanism. Capillary fluid shift mechanism, stress relaxation and reverse stress relaxation, and RAS-mediated vasoconstriction. What is RAS? RAS is renin-angiotensin system. This also I'll be teaching you today in detail. Renin-angiotensin aldosterone system. And finally, we have the long-term acting mechanisms, which are very, very slow to act. They take around 3 to 10 days. So they are taking a lot of time. They take 3 to 10 days. They are really slow. But the very important mechanism amongst these two are the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, also written in short as RAS, one of the favorites of everyone, and the renal fluid conservation mechanism by the phenomena or by the hormones, ANP, ADH, and aldosterone. Aldosterone you have heard about, ADH also you know, antidiuretic hormone also known as vasopressin. ANP I had told you last time in the class, remember ABC, ANP, BNP, CNP, atrial natriuretic peptide. They do two things, pressure natriuresis and pressure diuresis. Okay, iske bare mein I'll be talking about in detail. So today we have to cover all these important reflexes, and once we are done through them, we'll be looking at some lesser talked about reflexes in the theory, but commonly asked questions, especially the distinction questions for Viva, right? So first, let us know the basics and then we'll move to the distinction stuff. And please, when I say basics, to matlab basic to aana hi chahiye, right? You need to know this. If you are not able to tell the examiner baroreceptor reflex in the exam, it creates a very bad impression on the examiner, let me tell you. Even when I go to take exam, I ask CNS ischemia, baroreceptor, and if people tell it immediately, quickly, thoroughly, clearly, like I also want them to give 70% marks, right? And people are telling me all kind of absurd things, then definitely creates a very bad impression, because these are something which, you know, as your seniors call marked topics, right? You know, in medical college there is a terminology used, kya padhna hai. So people will commonly say marked wala topic padhna hai, marked, right? But please remember, I'm totally against this. Although we also used to do this when we were UGs. Kuch mark nahi hota hai, kuch unmark nahi hota hai. You understand, you are not going to become computer engineers, right? From IIT, you are becoming doctors, and that too, who are going to deal with human body. So you can't tell the patient after 10 years from now, ki nahi, wo maine padha nahi tha, that was not marked. Okay? That creates, that will really make mockery of you. So please, you should know what is important, but you should read everything. This is what I believe, right? So let's start with the first reflex, which is the baroreceptor reflex. Now we are starting with the first one in the list. The rapidly acting mechanisms, and we are beginning with the first one, which is baroreceptor reflex. Before I start with the baroreceptor reflex, hote kya hai baroreceptor? Where are they located? So let's try to learn a little bit about the baroreceptors. Baroreceptors are baroreceptors are coiled nerve endings. They are coiled nerve endings. Some people will say coiled or knobby or intertwined. These are just playing with the English language, right? So they are coiled nerve endings or intertwined knobby nerve endings located in characteristic locations in the blood vessels called as they are located in characteristic locations in the blood vessels which are called as sinuses. So baroreceptors are the coiled nerve endings located in the characteristic locations in the blood vessels called as or known as sinuses. Which layer of the blood vessel they are located? Tunica adventitia. Remember adventitia media intima, the outermost, right? So they are located in the tunica adventitia layer. The baroreceptors are the coiled nerve endings located in characteristic locations in the blood vessels known as sinuses. What do we understand by the term sinus? Sinus basically means dilated part of the blood vessel. Dilated part of the vessel. Let me do a further discussion about the two types of baroreceptors. The two types of baroreceptors are carotid sinus and aortic sinus. So I'll show you the scientist who discovered this. His name was Corney Hayman. So we'll discuss about him a little bit, historical aspect, and then I'll come back to this. But first of all, let us understand what is the difference between carotid and aortic sinus. So baroreceptors are coiled nerve endings located in characteristic locations in the blood vessels known as sinuses, which are nothing but dilated part of the vessel. When I say carotid sinus, the carotid sinus is 4 to 6 times more sensitive than aortic sinus. Secondly, who is more sensitive? Naturally, carotid sinus. Second point, their location. Carotid sinus is a dilatation of internal carotid artery, ICA is internal carotid artery, just above the bifurcation of common carotid artery. Dilated carotid sinus is a dilatation of the internal carotid artery. ICA is internal carotid artery just above the bifurcation of the common carotid artery. Aortic sinus is a dilatation located in transverse part of the aortic arch. Transverse part of the aortic arch near the root of left subclavian artery. This is supplied by the nerve known as the sinus nerve, which is actually a branch of glossopharyngeal nerve. And this is supplied by the aortic nerve, which is actually a branch of vagus. Now let us see how do they look like. So very easy figure which you all can draw in the exam. So this is the external carotid. And just try to understand what is the difference, what am I doing here. So we have this is my transverse part of the aortic arch where I have these coiled nerve endings. This part becomes aortic sinus. Remember, you had studied in respiratory system, there is one this projection coming out of the aortic arch. This is not sinus. Please understand, this is not a dilated part. This is aortic body. Right? So what is the difference between body and sinus? First things first. Right? Sinus is a baroreceptor, body is a chemoreceptor. Sinus is like, just look at this one. This is now carotid sinus. This is internal carotid artery. So this part is dilated. In this dilated part, we have coiled nerve endings, intertwined knobby endings. This is carotid sinus. If I draw like this another one, this becomes now carotid body. So please understand, sinus is not body, right? So I can make a figure-based question in the exam. I can write over here A, B, C, D, and I will ask you which out of A, B, C, D are baroreceptors, which are chemoreceptors, right? So carotid sinus and the aortic sinus are the baro. The bodies are nothing but they are coiled nerve endings projecting from the vessel wall. They are coiled nerve endings projecting out from the vessel wall. They are not located in the dilated part, right? So we should be extremely clear with body and sinus. Now, what is going to happen is we are going to discuss the carotid sinus in much more detail, because this is my, as I've already told you, main baroreceptor, right? It is the main one. Why? Because it is 4 to 6 times more sensitive. Let's look at the same thing over here. Just see quickly. This is the aortic arch. This is the aortic body, just a small projection. Again, this is the aortic arch. This is the carotid sinus. It is nothing but dilated part, right? So already I have drawn for you. And any other difference we should know? Yes, one or two important ones. Now, baroreceptors do not discharge. Baroreceptors do not discharge when your blood pressure is between 0 and 70 millimeter Hg. Please remember, baroreceptors show no discharge. That means they are not sensitive to. Baroreceptors show no discharge. Generally, we say baroreceptors, they are showing less discharge or less stimulation in the range of 0 to 70 millimeter Hg. When I say again, every pressure is mean arterial pressure. As soon as the pressure crosses 70 millimeter Hg, the baroreceptor will start getting stimulated. What do I mean here? Let me draw only the internal carotid artery in detail. You know that blood is coming like this into the internal carotid artery. As you know, we have just discussed that we have this one branch and the another one. So when the blood is reaching inside the carotid sinus, this is the sinus. When the blood pressure becomes more than 70, more blood will come to the carotid sinus. It will start stretching more. When it starts stretching more, it will send the information to my higher centers in the brainstem that your BP is rising. So more my blood pressure becomes greater than 70, there will be more stretching or stimulation of the baroreceptors, which will send the information to central nervous system to decrease the blood pressure, right? So we have a concept of working range. That means in what range does the baroreceptor work most effectively, a working range. And now I can say the working range of the carotid sinus is, the working range of the carotid sinus is 70 to 170 millimeter mercury, and working range of aortic sinus is 100 to 1200 millimeter Hg. That means they will start stimulating at 70 and their response will keep on increasing till 200. So combined range is 70 to 200. Please don't make yourself believe the wrong concept that at 200 they stop discharging. We are saying at 200 they are discharging maximum, but after 200 they will not further show increased discharge, right? So they have reached their maximum stimulation at 200, but after 200 they are useless. Below 70 they again become useless in regulation of blood pressure. So they will only work effectively in the range of 70 to 200, right? This is the carry home message here. So let's look at the scientist who discovered this for us. So very quickly, these all things I've already told you, just read. Let's read again in 1 minute and revise quickly in the mind. So short-term regulatory mechanisms, they begin to act within, I'm highlighting the key points, within second 2 minutes, right? They are useless or they lose their capability for pressure control after a few hours or days. Why? Because they are rapidly acting mechanisms. They are not intermediate or long acting. It occurs through neural pathways and targets the heart, blood vessels, and adrenal medulla. I'm going to teach you the pathway in a while. It includes various short mechanisms such as baroreceptor, chemo, and CNS ischemic response. This already I've told you. He was the man who discovered them for us. Name was Heymans. So Heymans was the first to demonstrate the baroreceptors are located in artery, cornea Heymans. So they are located in carotid sinus and aortic arch. I've already told you about it. And this is a table where we'll quickly revise the classification and location of the baroreceptors. We have two types of baroreceptors. One is known as high pressure, another is known as low pressure. So arterial baroreceptors are also called as high pressure baroreceptors. You know their location, carotid sinus, aortic arch. At least I will like you to believe, remember these two. For additional knowledge, maybe if you can remember, wonderful, but at least remember what I've told you till now. Carotid sinus, aortic arch, they are located in systemic circulation. The pulmonary trunk and its division into right and left pulmonary artery also have baroreceptors, which are again the arterial baroreceptors. Systemic ones are generally called as high pressure baroreceptors. Another lesser known locations are root of right subclavian artery and junction of thyroid artery with the common carotid artery. Again, I'm saying if you don't remember this, doesn't matter, remember 1 and 2. They only ask 1 and 2 in exam. But this is a figure taken from a research article. So that is why I'm trying to tell you all the locations. The other ones are located inside the heart, or maybe they are located at the junctions of vena cava with the right atrium and the pulmonary veins with the left atrium. They are actually known as low pressure. Their characteristic location is known as atriocaval receptor. That means located at the junction of right atrium with the inferior vena cava and superior vena cava. Pulmonary venoatrial receptors located at the junction of pulmonary veins with the left atrium, and some atrial and ventricular receptors, right? So the carry home message is, the key point to remember is, let's quickly summarize. We have two kinds, high and low pressure. High pressure in the arterial systemic circulation, carotid aortic sinus. Don't want to remember anything, leave it. Low pressure located at the junction of IVC with the right atrium and also pulmonary veins with the left atrium. That's it, known as atriocaval or pulmonary venoatrial, right? So these are the high and low. Why they are low pressure? Because you know in the atria, the pressures are very low. 0 to 3 and 4 to 6, not more than this, right? In diastole and systole. This is again the same figure taken from one of the very popular physiology books, which our PG students read, and that is known. This is boron. So this is again showing a detailed figure of the same thing. This one over below has been highlighted to and enlarged to show me this is an internal carotid artery. Just try to understand and focus here. This is a little stretched out part. So this is sinus, carotid sinus, right? And again, the supply, you know, 9th and 10th nerve already I have talked about. So we'll leave this. Tunica adventitia, I've already told you. This is a new modern concept. Just spend one minute on this. They are located in tunica adventitia, done. But please read the second line very carefully. The stretch of the baroreceptors leads to opening of ENaC. ENaC stands for epithelial sodium channel. So the modern day concept is that whenever the baroreceptors, remember this was the carotid sinus, so whenever the baroreceptors stretch, the stretching causes opening of epithelial sodium channels, there would be a sodium influx. And this sodium influx will cause depolarization, which will cause increased discharge in the 9th and 10th afferent nerves, right? That is the modern concept. TRPC stands for transient receptor potential calcium channels. Some people say that instead of sodium, after stretch, the calcium channels open. Calcium se bhi kya hoga? Same thing, I will have depolarization because positive ion is moving in. Transient receptor potential calcium channel. That is the another full name, right? So just remember the ENaC one. This is the most sought after and the most modern molecular mechanism to be accepted these days, right? So mechanism of baroreceptor action. Okay, let's now move on to the baroreceptor reflex arc or the mechanism in detail along with neurotransmitters. So let's start with the baroreceptor reflex. This each one of you will have to know, definitely, must know. And now I'm going to write the neurotransmitters as well. So baroreceptor reflex. Let's start with the problem. The problem in my patient is that his blood pressure is increasing. When his BP is increasing, this is the carotid sinus. So when the BP is increasing, this causes increased stretching of the baroreceptors, or it leads to, I can say, increased stimulation of the baroreceptors. So I will ask any one of you to unmute and trace the pathway for me in the opposite way in a while, right? Just after 5 minutes. So please listen to this very carefully. So increase in blood pressure causes increased stimulation of baroreceptors. Increased stimulation can be written as the same thing, increased stretching. But in exam, I prefer that you write stimulation, right? That is what most of the people will prefer in the exam. So increased stimulation or increased stretching, it is the same thing. This will cause increased discharge in 9th and 10th nerves, glossopharyngeal and the vagi. This information of the increased discharge, that means now I have come to know that my BP is rising. And once the BP is rising, their baroreceptors are showing increased stretching or increased stimulation. They send this information, increased discharge in 9th and 10th nerves, which are my afferents. They will send the information to the integrating station in the medulla, whose name we have discussed, NTS in medulla. So they reach NTS in the medulla and release the neurotransmitter glutamate over here. I think you must have been taught till now in CNS. If not, then remember, GABA and glycine are two main inhibitory neurotransmitters. Glutamate and aspartate are two main excitatory neurotransmitters. So please write it separately anywhere. Don't spoil your flowchart, but just remember, main two excitatory ones are glutamate and aspartate. Main two inhibitory ones are GABA and glycine, right? Just remember as of now this much. If he hasn't taught you this much in CNS, then at least you should be knowing up till here, this is the basic, right? So the afferent nerve discharge gets the information to NTS in the medulla. What was the NTS in the medulla? You know its name was, it was an integrating station. It is receiving all the information. It's an integrating station, right? It receives all the information. So it receives the information that BP is rising. What will you like to do? I will like to decrease the blood pressure. But how will I do that, right? That's the other part of the reflex. So remember glutamate till now. Now the NTS on medulla on getting stimulated, releases a neurotransmitter, which is NTS in the medulla on getting stimulated, releases a neurotransmitter, which is again glutamate. And the glutamate is going to stimulate, the center known as CVLM. What was CVLM? Now I won't be telling you again. Caudal ventrolateral medulla. CVLM on getting stimulated releases GABA and inhibits the center known as RVLM. So are you with me in this? Yes, you should be, right? Not at all difficult if you write down carefully. So as soon as the information of the increased blood pressure goes via the afferent nerves, which are 9th and 10th nerves, remember the information will reach the integrating station, which is the NTS, nucleus of tractus solitarius in the medulla, which releases glutamate, stimulates CVLM, which releases GABA and inhibits RVLM. That means in a nutshell, what I have done through these pathway is I have done inhibition of my sympathetic discharge. I have decreased my sympathetic discharge. Got it? And what will happen if the sympathetic discharge decreases? Yes, you know about it. It will decrease heart rate. It will decrease stroke volume. It will decrease total peripheral resistance. But as the NTS in the medulla gets stimulated, it also sends the information and stimulates the area known as CVIC or nucleus ambiguus. Cardiovagal inhibitory center, new name, nucleus ambiguous. As the nucleus ambiguous is stimulated, this will lead to increased vagal discharge. We understand that the vagal discharge does not do much effect on the stroke volume via contractility, but vagal discharge is definitely going to cause decrease in heart rate. Right? So till now, things are clear with the neurotransmitter. Let's club everything and normalize this blood pressure. So stroke volume into decreased heart rate. What does this give me? Stroke volume into heart rate, a huge decrease in cardiac output. Decrease in cardiac output and decrease in total peripheral resistance. What does this give me? Decrease in mean arterial pressure. And this is what we wanted, right? So decrease in mean arterial pressure means this BP will now be decreased or normalized back to normal. If you can trace this flowchart for me in the exam, it really, really creates a wonderful concept in your mind. It will recreate the concept and examiner will be impressed that yes, you are able to tell each and everything. What is RVLM? What is CVLM? And later on, gradually from 4-5 years from now, when you start preparing for the PG exams, lot of people will start next year only, right? So then you will realize that this RVLM, CVLM, that is what they ask. Suppose, let's make a question like this. They will ask you, if the person goes from, just try to listen to this carefully now. If the person goes from standing to supine, right? Or what we do commonly in exam in labs, physiology labs, supine position to standing. Let's do the blue one. So person was in lying down position, you ask him stand up. He immediately stands up. He goes from supine to standing position. When he goes from supine to standing position, in the standing position, there would be venous pooling of the blood. Venous pooling will lead to decreased venous return. Decreased venous return will lead to decreased cardiac output, leading to fall in blood pressure. But you know, none of us gets dizzy or giddy, and none of us will fall to the ground. Why? Because within 10 to 15 seconds, the baroreceptor will normalize your blood pressure. Within 10 to 15 seconds, baroreceptor reflex in this situation normalizes the blood pressure. Baroreceptor reflex normalizes the blood pressure. Right? So let us try to trace this one for the exam. I'll ask anyone who can unmute, right? Let's see. So I'm going from supine to standing. You will have to trace the same pathway for me. Now, instead of this pathway which I have drawn, it will change a little. And now I will start like this. That now the initial problem is decrease in mean arterial pressure, right? Decrease in mean arterial pressure. So what will happen when we have decrease in mean arterial pressure? It will lead to more stimulation or less stimulation? Less stimulation of baroreceptors. Less discharge in 9th and 10th nerves. Less stimulation of NTS. Less stimulation of CVLM. Less inhibition of RVLM. Increased sympathetic discharge. Less stimulation of vagal center. Decreased vagal discharge. What will happen? Everything will change. Increase in total peripheral resistance. Increase in stroke volume. Increase in heart rate. Increase in heart rate. Very quick increase in cardiac output, leading to increase in mean arterial pressure. Okay, so sab kuch ulta ho gaya, everything reverses. So you should be intelligent enough to trace an exam whether the examiner is asking you standing to supine or supine to standing, right? So what is the clinical significance of baroreceptor? The most important role of baroreceptor is, let's write down what I just traced for you. The baroreceptor reflex, the most important role is it prevents erratic fluctuations in blood pressure. It prevents erratic fluctuations in blood pressure due to emotional or postural changes. It prevents erratic fluctuations in blood pressure due to emotional or postural changes. Emotional, postural, we understand the example is written in front of you, supine to standing. Emotional, when I'm feeling angry on someone, right, my blood pressure shoots up. Immediately, the baroreceptor will try to calm you down, right? That is emotional and postural changes. It's a very, very rapidly acting reflex. Remember, it takes only seconds to minutes. So, this reflex is only useful in rapid regulation of blood pressure, right? So now let us revise what we have discussed. So this is a figure again taken from Boron, and what they are trying to tell me, already I have told you the same pathway. Let's just revise 2 or 3 times so that after I leave this class now, once after 1 hour, you should be absolutely clear in your mind, and everyone should of you will be able to trace the pathway. Right, so let's do this once more. Increase in mean arterial pressure, who is detecting baroreceptor, increased stimulation of baroreceptor, where is the coordinating center, medulla, naam nahi likha hai yahan, but you know NTS, already I have told you, NTS in the medulla, efferent pathways, he has skipped one or two steps, but I don't want you to skip, when the BP is increasing, you understand, it will lead to vasodilatation of the blood vessel, decrease in TPR, decrease in heart rate, decrease in stroke volume. This is what everything is mentioned here. It will lead to bradycardia, vasodilation, and that will counteract the increased mean arterial pressure, right? Remember, the key is that flowchart which I have traced for you, and that is the flowchart which I just did, that is given actually in Genong and all these standard books, but they have not made it properly. So the purpose of the class was that this should become absolutely clear to each one of you, right? So let's do some more. Yeah, very interesting figure from Guyton now. First of all, just try to see what we are doing here. Very interesting figure. So remember, we have two carotid arteries. We have common carotid. We are constricting common carotid. Just focus on the left side. And I hope you can see the figure clearly. I will enlarge for you a little bit. This is, remember, the carotid sinus. I have constricted the vessel. That means if this is the carotid sinus and blood is supposed to come like this, over here, I have done constriction. I have narrowed the vessel. So what will happen? What should be happening to the carotid sinus located within? When I do constrictors, apply kar diya. Constrictor is a device which is applied to narrow the lumen. When I apply the constrictors on just in the carotid, both the common carotids, what will happen? There will be immediately, now please see what happens. When I constrict both the common carotids, immediately the pressure in the carotid sinus will decrease. That means there will be less stimulation of the baroreceptor. So your brain will receive the information that BP is decreasing. Right? The brain will sense that BP is decreasing. So what will brain like to do? Brain will like to increase the sympathetic stimulation and decrease the vagal stimulation, leading to increase in arterial pressure. Now let's look at the figure. As soon as I clamp, both three common carotids are clamped, immediately the arterial pressure, the baroreceptors will judge that there is less stimulation, and the nucleus tractus solitarius will immediately increase the blood pressure. So BP immediately increases. Then it remains steady. And as I release the carotid clamps, as the carotid clamps are released, immediately the sinuses will start getting perfused with blood and the BP will fall down. So this is a figure which is showing me what will happen if I do clamping or narrowing of the common carotids. There are some wonderful questions here which we can try to attempt, although it will take extra 5 minutes, but you will really be forced to think over here. What will happen when there is occlusion of the carotid sinus? This is a common line here. And let me make the first question as, what will happen when there is occlusion of carotid sinus distal to its origin? Question number two, what will happen if there is occlusion of the carotid sinus proximal to its origin, right? So let us try to do that. The choices are increase in blood pressure, decrease in heart rate, decrease in blood pressure, increase in heart rate, increase in BP, increase in heart rate, decrease in BP, decrease in heart rate, right? So occlusion of carotid sinus distal and proximal, right? I hope everyone has seen the question. Chale, I'll ask any one of you. Let's see if anyone can give the right answer. Let me see. So I'll just ask randomly anyone, right? So please don't take it personally. In case you tell the right answer, wonderful. Okay, so let me try with unmuting. Sonia Verma, can you unmute yourself? Can you do that? Yes, Sonia Verma, can you unmute yourself? No. Okay, Sonia, just write your answer in the chat box. Just write the answer, whatever you feel like. Occlusion, distal decrease in heart rate and BP. Okay, Kriti Prajapati has given me the answer. Decrease in heart rate and BP, proximal increase. 1D, 2C. Abhishek, Anushka, yes. Everybody start writing. Wonderful. So I think that would be a better way because I don't think there is some problem in this and we can't unmute. So just I'll expect some quick answers from all of you. 1D, 2C, 1D, 2C, 1D, 2C, 1D, 2C. Okay, most of the people are giving me 1D, 2C. Let me see whether this is right or wrong. So, okay, I'll just see. So, what happens here is, remember, it is originating like this, right? So, maybe I'll just leave this external carotid artery out of the picture and just focus on ICA. The blood normally goes like this into the